needs, academic needs, theater, a place where people can meet.
We have the audience and
the practice
for each other.
Examples of women.
Sharing. What is the need to share? How do you do that?
There is no way you can ignore Latinos anymore. No, 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 no,
no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no,
no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no,
a whole scene of phenomenal theater for everybody, yes, everybody.
That's good for it to be done.
That's good for it to be done.
And if you are looking at the right relationship, then
so welcome everybody to the Martin E. Segal Theater Center here at the Graduate Center CUNY, and thank you for waiting a couple of more minutes. Some people are late, also supporters from the National Black Theater who helped us. But I think we're now going to go and start. My name is Frank Henschker, and the director of the Martin Segal Theater Center, and together with Antje Oegel, who's my co-director of programs, Antje was here, we prepared this, what we think will be an extraordinary evening celebrating the art and culture, life and spiritual forces of Yoruba. It's a fantastic project that was developed by the Royal Court and the Young Vic, and we have with us Elyse Dodgson, who is the mentor of the project. She coordinated all the five playwrights. She will tell a little bit more about the project. Just for you to know, she runs a program that is actually legendary in the world for over 25 years. She creates, runs, and develops the International Writers Program of the Royal Court. I think it is without any equals around the globe, and it has done so much for the world of theater, the global world, and for an understanding. So it's a really big, big honor to have you here. She flew in from London to be with us and also to make sure we do it right. And we did, I hope. So again, thank you for coming. And she will say a very few words, then our director will say some introductory words. The reading will be about 85 to 90 minutes. And there will be a little panel discussion here. You don't have to stay, but if you want, you come here. Then after the discussion, as a reward, is a little reception in case you stayed here for longer. It is some wine, but I don't think you all can get it. So, but we have water and pretzels, and that's exciting. So now is the moment. If you have a cell phone, take it out, and I'll do the same. And make sure it is off. Sound off. Yeah, is it? Oops. Yeah. Okay. All that. So again, thank you for coming, especially in this busy time without the holidays. We need great theater, but we also really do need a good and great audience. So it means a lot for us that you come here, and I hope you will see the world a little bit differently whenever it comes to Yoruba and after the evening. Yeah, Elyse, give us a little.
Just a little. This project started in 2007, more or less, because by sheer coincidence, we were working, as Frank says, we work with writers all over the world, and we had a project in Nigeria, we had another one in Cuba, and we had another one in Brazil. And I always say the project started on a beach in Lagos, where some of the writers said, "Where are you going next?" And I said, "Oh, well, we have a long-term project in Cuba." And they said, "Oh, no, no, you must tell us about our religion in Cuba, Santeria." And then it moved on where the writers in Brazil actually asked if I could bring some soil from Nigeria to them. And we did all of that. And it took many years, but by 2010, we had the Young Vic on board and the director, Rufus Norris. And by 2013, we produced Feast at the Young Vic. And it's absolutely thrilling to see it having a further life here. So thank you.
Hey, everybody. How are you guys doing?
Great.
Good. Thank you so much for being here. We have been working a little bit last night and most of today to present a little taste of this amazing play for you. So what you're going to see is a staged reading of this piece to bring to life a little bit of what the production was in London a couple years ago. There's music and projections and a little bit of dance and some amazing actors, but mostly I just wanted to say thank you for being here and enjoy Feast.
Another version of Eshu. Shola enters, hits the ground with his stick.
Wipe one.
Ashishi.
Ashishi.
Hey, ashishi.
Ashese
Mojuba.
Ashese Mojuba.
Ashese mistake. Ashese Mojuba. I lay my head down in homage to Nisab. Since the beginning of time, human behavior has evolved to avoid mishap and the unknown that comes in its wake. The teacher proclaims war against it. The secularist proclaims its existence as never more than human error. Muslim and Christian alike pray to accept it. Inshallah, God willing, should mishap occur, then who am I to argue? But in Yoruba, we know that mishapan will happen. The banana skins of life, the uneven paving stone, the email lost in cyberspace, the elephant trampling your chicken, half of your race, being enslaved and forced across the sea, the very inevitability of what's the line?
Mishap!
You all look very beautiful tonight, by the way. Did they tell you that when you walked in? Okay, so mishap is a fact of life. And within its consequence and chaos is the opportunity to learn, to grow, to adapt, to survive. So we embrace it. We lay our head down in homage and chant Ashe-she at the beginning of each new endeavor. Ashe-she. Okay, you are with me, okay? I'm going to say Ashe-she and then you are going to repeat it with me, okay? Ashe-she.
Ashe-she.
Hey, better. Hey, double time. Ashe-she.
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 Ashe-she. Hey, boo, boo, boo. We are here now. We are here.
White two.
Ashe-she Mojuba, ki en tawo shawo, ki en tawo shawo, yeah. Ashe-she Mojuba, ki en tawo shawo, aruni lawo. Ashe-she Mojuba, ki en tawo shawo, ki en tawo shawo, yeah. Ashe-she Mojuba, ki en tawo shawo, aruni lawo. Ashe-she Mojuba, ki en tawo shawo, ki en tawo shawo, yeah.
White three.
A performer dances the house egugun, a masquerade dance. It is a visual manifestation of the spirit of the ancestors.
White four.
A dancer does the samba carrying a tray of eggs.
White five and six.
The dancers clear the stage. Young Eshu returns.
I am back. You thought I was done with you, eh? Okay, Ori. Ori. Ori.
Ori.
Ori.
Ori.
Ori, the inner head. The entire Yoruba culture comes down to Ori. See, your inner head, who you really are. whether you know it or not, the whole of this universal belief system comes down to this concept, Ori. Your life's work is to know your Ori and live by it. Know you and be you and do you, whatever it is. Just do you. Self-knowledge. Orisha. Okay, I have to break it down. I'm sorry. Orisha.
Orisha.
Say it.
Orisha.
My man, love is me. Good. Okay, Orisha.
Orisha.
Is the word for deity. These Yoruba saints are your guides, your parents. They act as the maps to your natural desires or warning manuals for your weaknesses. There are 401 Orishas, and we are all children of one or another of them. You will meet three of them. You will meet three of the women this evening. Yemoya. Yemoya. Oshun. Oya.
Oya.
Yeah, you will follow them over 300 years of history. Along the way, they will meet me. Eshu. Eshu. Eshu.
Eshu.
Yeah, that's me. The crosswords, the crossroads dweller. The shapeshifter, the trickster Orisha who throws a stone today that hits someone yesterday. No journey is undertaken without Eshu casting his eye over one's chances of safe passage. Woe betide the traveler who takes success for granted without first making offering to him.
Wipe seven is unsuccessful.
Excuse me.
A chicken squawks. Old Eshu is revealed with a chicken and stool.
Excuse me. I have to prepare a family meal, a birthday party. I have to make a cake. I need some eggs. This is Saint Anthony. He got reincarnated and it didn't go well. Saint Anthony is keen to bless the meal. I advise him to be careful for what he wishes for.
Eshu speaks to the children.
Eggs, Saint Anthony. Only a blind and deaf chicken will be trampled by the elephant.
Eshu listens to the chicken.
He says he who runs after an innocent chicken will trip on a sheshe. Eh, we will see. I am expecting guests, St. Anthony. Three lady friends. They have been traveling for a long while and they will be hungry. Eggs!
He sings a sheshe.
Oh, yeah.
He hits the ground with his stick.
Three proud women journeying from one town to another for a family feast. Yemoya, the deep water, caring and furious as the sea. Oshun, the vain, generous, distracted and totally distracting. Oya, the forceful, who kicks up a storm and pulls the wind like a net. Three sisters, cousins, daughters, aunties, mothers, to a destiny they cannot yet know and probably would not choose. And here they are, approaching the crossroads of their life. Nothing compares to the pleasures at the crossroads. Saint, man and chicken, male and female, old and young, grand theater of the world, streaming past in the absolute certainty that each step will take them toward where they want to go. The crossroads, however, is never a friend to the absolute. In the constant shadow of certainty is chaos.
We hear drumming. There is a dance. Eshu lays the leaves along the path and on the sand to the left.
Welcome to my home.
Hurry up, you!
Hey, don't tell me to hurry up.
You are so slow.
I'm exhausted.
You are lazy.
I'm not lazy. This is so heavy, it's ruining my hair.
Then cut it off. No one will notice.
Just because you have bush hair.
I don't have bush
hair. You have bush hair. Your hair is like a water buffalo.
And your backside is
your
like a
face
buffalo.
Is enough!
Ah!
Ah. Oh, a crossroads.
We go straight.
There's a shrine of Oshun this way,
I'm not visiting any more of your boring shrines.
They're not boring, you are just foolish.
Straight on.
Oh, Uncle's place is to the left. We could check if he's still at home and travel with him.
We'll be late for the meal. Exactly. It's midday already. Shango will have been waiting for me since sunrise.
Pygmy.
He's not a pygmy.
My darling, he's a pygmy. Consult a doctor.
He's a loving man. And where is yours?
Ah, you know I can get plenty of men, no trouble.
Very
some men.
You can get them. But can you keep them?
At least I can see them. Shango, hello, Shango. Oh, down, down.
I'm going to finish with you.
Hey, the world has done me much harm. The world has done me much harm.
How is that our business?
You, a part of the world. Give me a little food.
You're a smelly old goat. I mean that as a compliment.
And you are a fragrant young lamb. I mean that as a warning.
We are not to blame for whatever harm was done to you.
Or for you being so old and smelly.
Hey, a little offering. Something sweet.
The leaf that is sweet to the goat kills the goat.
Was sweet in goat's mouth?
Goes sour in the bonbon.
Hey, hey, some food for the cripple.
The goat should eat the grass where it is tied.
Eat your girlfriend.
Hey, let's go.
Pardon my asking, but where exactly are you going?
We are going to a family feast, a birthday celebration. The only goats there will be the ones we will eat. You are not invited, eh? Come on, let's go.
At least I am a goat at peace.
Not even your girlfriend will envy you.
Even though your boyfriend would.
Who?
Poor Shango.
Who told you about him?
What is he talking about?
What happened to Shango?
Oh, you don't know.
Don't know what? What?
You shouldn't have mentioned her boyfriend.
Speak, you sniveling cripple.
She loves that midget.
What did you just say?
Nothing.
Better for you. Oh yeah, be quick.
All I want is a little food. You won't regret it.
This is sweet. Eat this.
Oh.
Has something bad happened to him?
A terrible misfortune.
What?
He fell in love with you.
Stop it! Stop it!
You go kill him, oh. Move.
What's funny?
There was another misfortune.
What?
War.
Hey! Kai! Bloody liar!
Just stop, leave these goats.
Hey, see the foliage on the ground? It's vegetation the invaders use to camouflage their numbers as they pass.
Then why are you still here? A war foretold should not kill a cripple.
Only a foolish snail tries to outrun a dog. Anyway, soldiers have no use for a crooked old goat, but you, for the three are you.
We can go left instead.
We need to get to the feast.
We will find refuge at Omo's house. Is that so just now?
If you don't starve to death in the interval, that is.
How?
Famine.
I don't believe this.
Hey, can't you see the sand? The wind blew it in from the desert last month and killed everything.
Let's keep going straight.
Getting raped by soldiers is not of my overriding ambition in life.
Why don't we go right? We'll take refuge in Oshun Shrine. No soldier would dare defile the sacred grove of the goddess.
Slavers have no regard for men or God.
What?
Did you say slavers?
Yeah, they'd be glad to lay their hands on you.
Oh. Trickster!
He holds up a leg shackle.
Perhaps you can give it to them when you meet them. Hey, now, don't be hasty. Respect the crossroads, and it will let you pass untroubled. You have one last chance. Give me some food.
Blind idiot, I'm turning back.
Can you hear that?
Where? Who's coming? I hear it now. From the direction we came. A horseman.
Who's coming?
They're super. Two horsemen.
Oh, he is not looking good.
Yes, man. Here.
Hey, three horsemen.
Come back. Are you crazy? We'll be safe at the shrine. Go to uncle's. Have you forgotten from the family? It's all lies. You just mean to keep me. I'm here and I'm
here. Hey, listen. Don't hold the steps.
No. Wait.
I'm going. Are you coming with me?
No.
Goodbye.
You drive. trapped your food.
Who are you?
Hey, have you forgotten me, sister?
Eshu?
Yemoya backs away as the slavers approach. Scene 3, the bottom line. There is a dance, a song, a prayer. Yemoya is transported through the middle passage. We see projected images of the routes around the world during the transatlantic slave trade and of sail documents. Brazil, 1888. May 1888, on the eve of the abolition of slavery in Brazil by the royal decree of Princess Isabel. In a farmhouse, Senor Zinho, a white man of about 30, and Yamanja, a black slave woman of many years. He has papers in front of him.
You're free.
Don't put your heart in your hand over this. I won't say a word, not a word. I'll hide over there by the slave quarters. No one will ask and no one need know.
If you stayed, you'd have to start earning wages. You know that?
You can just give me food, that's all, that's all.
Wages is money.
You give me the money, I'll give it back to you.
Not money, not housing, nothing. I don't want any blacks planning their riots on my farm. Itching to slit my throat. From this day on, all I've got to give any slave is that open door. After that, the field gate open. Beyond the farm gate, also open. Beyond that, the road, Yemanja. The road with no sheriffs, no patrols. Just the wide open road.
And then?
And then the world.
I've never seen it.
Go and see it.
My little Senor Zinho, didn't Yemanja give you milk? Wasn't I your wet nurse from the very first day? I gave you my breast. Wasn't that right?
It was right. It was like that. It was. I drank your milk.
That's right.
The milk meant for your children. What became of them?
After all this time, nobody knows anymore.
No. No one knows. My father sold them all.
For the children in the house. No. That was his law.
The milk was left for me alone.
Just give me a little time. I'll look. Find someone to buy me, someone who needs an old black lady. Take care of the house, look after the mistress's children, just. A little more time. I'll find a buyer.
Are you deaf? Are you mad? Brazil doesn't have slaves anymore. And if there are no more slaves, slaves can't be bought. From today, Yemanja is a free woman. The princess doesn't want any slaves in Brazil.
Young people, so full of ideas. And I'm too old to put up with them. I can't take it. I don't understand young people and their big ideas.
Not just ideas, law. It's by order of the law that you have to get out of here today. See the sun? When it sets, when it goes red, you will be long gone. When day breaks, I don't want any more slaves here. Not one. It's the law.
Oh, I knew your father's law.
My father is dead. His law is worthless now. I died with him. I lost a big chance. A fine opportunity. I should have sent you all away much sooner. I might have even gotten a special commendation from the crown. That would have been nice. Bankrupt, but with a commendation. A little shiny badge to show off in town, to wear on my lapel at night, going to the theater. Now it's no slaves, no commendation, no nothing. My inheritance. My inheritance.
Yemanja sings Yemaya Asheshu. Senor Zinho joins in but then stops. Yemanja then also stops singing.
Show me your breast, Yemanja. Does your breast still give milk?
Me?
Does your breast still give milk?
Senor, Senor, you're playing with me.
No, I am asking. Seriously. Well, if you don't have any more milk, what use are you to me? You're of no use to me. For anything.
From deep in my soul, I swear to you, I don't want any bad for you.
And I don't want anything bad for you. But today you leave the farm. You're a free woman. You exchange your house and your bread and you get liberty. Life is cruel. Go and look for your children. Another age is coming. And if that means paying wages on my farm, then it won't be to blacks. Never. But I promise you, if they rise up here, Yemanja, there'll be a lot of blood, and it won't be mine. If every black is now a citizen, he should know the law. Now he has rights. I hope he knows how to use them well. Ask the God and the saints for help. Ask your black God.
He offers her money.
Here. Wages. For the milk of your sons.
He throws coins down and sits. She picks up the coins, places them back on the table. His shoe is at the door. She takes one piece of food and offers it to him. The door opens. She steps through. Scene 4B, shelter.
A dance. Yemanya is now free and is roaming the streets of Brazil looking for shelter.
Hey, Babatunde. Hey, Babatunde.
1905. The road, US. Imanja touches the ground and falls back.
Wade in the water. Wade in the water, children. Wade in the water. God's gonna trouble the water. Wade in the water. Wade in the water, children. Wade in the water.
God's gonna trouble the water.
Ale, 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 ale.
Sit down, sisters. Sit down. The road is long and the crossroads many, so sit down in this house of God and rest your weary bones. This is a place where we can all take a shovel from the mountain of Galilee and build our own promised land. Confide in God. And don't say, I don't confine your mind to the ways of the devil. We no longer worship in the forest, prostrating ourselves to false idols, cutting the heads off chickens. Walk away. I say walk away from the path of hedonists and get to know the Lord your Father. Because a person who doesn't know his ancestors doesn't know his grandchildren. And even the tortoise said that had father been an easily acquired title, everybody would have borne it. Resist these temptations to dance with the devil, because if there is no crack in the wall, the lizard will not. I say, he will not enter. The lion's den of the soul is not a playground for goats. And the crocodile that conceives gives birth only to trouble. For now, behold, tomorrow is pregnant. And nobody, nobody, nobody knows what it is. Will give birth to.
There is a dance, the Civil Rights Walk.
Ain't gonna love nobody.
Scene 6. Nashville, USA, 1960. Awoye Park's lunch counter. Eshu and Oya, both on the team, are sitting at a counter, looking straight ahead. Oya gets splattered with ketchup by a white man.
Keep on talking, marching on to freedom land.
Excuse me. Excuse me, sir. I'm thirsty.
Me too.
I'm gonna order a tall glass of milk.
Don't.
But my throat is a dying man wandering the Sahara. Indeed, it seems you both have a rendezvous with life.
Keep your voice down.
Oh, right, I forgot. I'm supposed to just sit here and keep letting white folks beat up on me without so much as a peep. I'm hungry.
You can leave whenever you want. I'm staying until they serve us. What more could they do, mustard?
You look right fine in ketchup. You know what I'm gonna have? A hot dog with everything. Want one?
Eshu.
Onions. Fries. Pancakes.
Who takes the time to joke around, Eshu?
Awoye?
Oh, sure, you changed your mind about joining us?
Mama sent me to bring you home. Dear God, what have they done to you?
It's all right, it's ketchup.
How did you get ketchup all over you?
Now, some white man who wasn't happy about having to sit next to a colored gal.
Disgusting. It's gonna stain, Oya.
At least it's not blood.
Yeah, this is blood.
I should have known he was behind this. He's been nothing but trouble ever since we met him.
I'm staying right here, Oshun.
And you should be home, safe. But here you are getting in trouble as I'm sitting.
Ain't no trouble here.
There's about to be. They called the cops.
Really?
Yes, really. The police.
Let them come.
Oya.
Oshun.
You know we don't have the money to bail you out of jail. To say nothing of the fact that our family does not get arrested. We do not break the law, and we do not have criminal records. That's not who we are.
Meaning I'm supposed to sit idly by and watch people just run roughshod all over our rights?
Look, I understand. You go off to college, and certain people take advantage of idealism and know the world is not as beautiful as it could be. But this won't do any good if you aren't in jail. He's riffraff.
Oshun, you ought to be ashamed of yourself. Walking in here insulting people who just want change.
I should be ashamed?
You can go now.
You never used to be like this.
Like how?
Disrespectful. Mama and Daddy didn't raise you like that.
They didn't raise you to sit around like a sack of marbles when there's a fight to join.
Do you know how hard it's been for Daddy? Trying to build a practice all his own as a Negro man? You ever thought about the years of work and sacrifice he put in to raise us?
Of course I have.
So what does it look like, you sitting here breaking the law? Any second, the police are gonna rush in here, and those sweet voices you hear outside singing are gonna be replaced by sirens and dogs and billy clubs. I saw the pictures from the Chattanooga newspaper. This is real life, Oya. These cops, when they get angry, they don't know anything about respect or decency or chivalry. They beat women just the same as they beat men. You want the cops to break your nose? Black your eye?
If that's what it takes.
Well, I can't stay here and watch this.
Then go!
I'm going. Here.
What?
I brought you some food.
Food?
I'm waiting to get served here.
Please come home.
I know you think we can all just get along and eventually things will improve. I know you believe that deep in your bones, Oshun. But harmony now isn't the real way to peace. You run from a fight long enough, you won't ever be able to stop running.
What am I supposed to tell Mama? She'll beat me senseless if I come home without you.
You could stay here.
You don't expect
Why
me to.
Why not? If you're gonna get beat anyway.
I can't. I don't. I don't demonstrate. I'm engaged to be married.
Oh. And I suppose we're all just promiscuous degenerates.
That's not what I meant.
Excuse me, sisters. Oshun, one day you're gonna be an old, old lady. And people are gonna know you were here. And they're gonna ask you what you did. What you gonna tell them?
It's not that simple.
It's exactly that simple. Either you believe in this or you don't. If you don't, that's fine. You can drink out of your own special Oshun water fountains and pay your own special Oshun poll taxes. But if you believe in this, I'm happy to give you my seat.
I've never been arrested before.
Trust me, it gets easier after the first couple of times.
If she wants to leave, as she let her leave.
Can you just be quiet and let me think? I need to go call Mama.
Of course you do.
I beg your pardon.
Hello, sister.
What about Bill?
Don't worry about that now.
Turn me
Where's
Eshu?
Turn me Eshu? Around. Turn Eshu, stop fooling! We're gonna just sit here and enjoy the song.
I'm gonna keep on talking, keep on walking, marching up to freedom land.
Sounds of the music begin to mix with the sounds of a growing and violent commotion.
Turn me
Oya reaches for Oshun's hand.
Turn me around, turn me around. Ain't gonna let nobody turn me around. I'm gonna keep on walking, keep on talking,
marching up to freedom land.
Scene 7, Identity. We see a series of photographs projected behind Oyad Oshun. The images show moments of resistance and defiance. They soon transform into portraits of men and women who were arrested during the civil rights movement, as well as numerous artists from that time forward. Then there is a celebration dance performed by the dance ensemble. It is a dance of joy, celebrating music and dance and the Yoruba rhythms throughout time.
Calendar with Fidel Castro's face on it. In one corner, on a small altar, sits Babalu Aye, watching over every inch of the room. On the altar, there are also candles, cups of corn, glasses with small amounts of wine. A couple enters. She is mulatta, around 40. He looks American. They talk.
Make yourself comfortable.
Much nicer than my hotel.
Don't make fun.
No, seriously, I like your room.
Yamaya pours some rum into two glasses, offers one of them to John.
This is Cuba.
This is poverty. As soon as I get some money together, I want to change everything. Paint the walls white. Oh, I can get a decent air conditioner, a flat screen TV. Ooh. Hopefully, this will look like your hotel room one day.
Boring?
Nice looking, comfortable, modern. That's all I'm interested in. I'll be back in a minute. I just, have to use the bathroom.
Yemoya takes off her heels and goes into the bathroom. John goes up to the calendar and touches Fidel's beard.
Be ashamed to change all this.
This place is fine, John. Your name is John, isn't it?
Yes.
Right.
John Smith.
Ah. Well, I want to spend the rest of my life here. So, I want to make it habitable.
Thought you'd want to leave.
Then go where?
Anywhere abroad.
Why?
I've heard that all Cubans want to leave.
Well, I am the exception to that.
That's strange.
Why?
Because you're...
Oh, whore. Yes, I am a communist whore.
Yunior comes out of the bathroom wearing a gown that's almost transparent.
Don't laugh, I'm dead serious. I am an anti-imperialist whore.
You are about to go to bed with the enemy.
Exactly. The two of us are going to do battle, body on body, in that bed. The only difference is that you will leave this room $50 poorer, and I'll be able to make a small contribution to my country's economy. So you see, Cuba is beating the U.S. even in bed. And besides, I can't live without the ocean.
Yamaya puts out the San Lazaro candles, takes a sheet, and covers the saint with it.
Why did you do that?
It's not good to take your clothes off in front of him.
Why?
Forget it. It's complicated.
I want to know.
I thought you wanted to cool off with me.
Is it some kind of secret, the thing with the saint?
No, it's not a secret. Issue is very jealous. If a woman gets undressed in front of him, then later she'll find it very hard to find men. He's a complicated santo.
Why do you have it then?
I'm his daughter. In the religion, you know? You don't get to choose your parents, they get given to you.
Yamaya sits on John, kisses him. He doesn't move.
Well, what's wrong?
Nothing.
Well, you don't want her anymore?
I'm fine.
Did I do something to scare you?
Of course not.
Okay. I'm talking too much.
I like talking to you.
I like you to like doing something else.
Yeah, I'd like you that way too.
You're not excited.
Yamaya.
Who told you my name?
You did?
No. I never tell my name until I get paid.
Someone in the bar told me you were Yamaya.
The place is full of prostitutes. I wasn't the exact best offer there. Why would anyone tell you I'm Yamaya?
Because I was looking for you.
Yamaya sits up. She takes the sheet off San Lazaro and covers herself with it.
No, I'm going to have to ask you to leave.
I didn't mean to give you a fright.
You didn't.
No, Yamaya.
Stop saying my name. And tell me, why the hell are you looking for me?
Because I'm bankrupt.
And what's that got to do with me? I charge the same like every other prostitute. $50.
Here it is. I'm paying you. It's fine.
What is this?
The crisis. Yamaya.
Yamaya takes a machete out from its hiding place underneath the altar.
Don't be stupid.
I am a black communist prostitute. I've got every reason in the world to mistrust someone like you. I bet your name is even made up to start with John Smith. Do I look stupid to you? What do you think I am, Pocahontas?
God's sake, I'm just a normal American who's broke, needs your help. Look, here's my name. Look, John Smith. Loads of people are named John Smith in America. I come in peace. I don't care that you're a communist. I certainly couldn't care that you're black. I voted for Obama. Put that fucking thing away and calm down.
I swear that you voted for Obama.
I swear to God.
Swear on something that matters to you.
I swear on my children.
How do I know you even got any?
I've got their photos in there. Look.
Yamaya takes his wallet and is persuaded. She puts the machete back.
John Smith. You're not from the CIA, are you?
Of course I'm not.
Mm-hmm. Tell me what you're doing here then.
A friend told me I should.
What friend?
He was here 3 months ago. He gave me your details and the name of the bar. Do you remember him? The fat guy with a beard? His name is Christopher.
Oh, yeah, I remember him. He paid me double, didn't even want to have sex, just wanted to talk.
Exactly.
I still don't understand. How could that guy recommend a prostitute he didn't even blink?
I'm not interested in you as a prostitute, Yamaya. What I need is a Santero. You can laugh all you want. But my friend got out of his mess because of you. I can tell you, that he tried everything and been everywhere. And none of it did any good. Only you.
You've come to the wrong place. gonna give you the address to my friend. He's the one you're looking for.
I came to this country looking for Yamoya.
And you were mistaken. I am not no Santera. I'm just a normal believer, doubts and all. I look after my saint. I'm no fanatic. I don't have any powers or anything. This friend of mine, he is a Babalawo. He's closer to the Orishas than me.
I don't believe in your Orishas. I risked a lot to come and see you. Give me a few minutes of your time, I beg you.
All right, that's enough.
I'll pay you double if you want.
I can't help you.
You helped Christopher.
That's not even true.
Everything you told him?
It was...
worked.
It was all lies. I thought he'd find it exciting if I played up the exotic thing and started making stuff up. None of it was true.
Got him out of his crisis.
Look at me. What could I possibly understand about capitalist crisis? We live in a fucking permanent crisis right here. What on earth could I possibly tell you?
Anything right now, anything would help.
I don't read shells, I don't read hands or any of that stuff. I can't read your future.
Ask your saint.
John.
Try it, at least know.
All right. I'm gonna prove to you that I don't have any powers. I'm gonna prove to you that he's just a lump of plaster, then you can fuck off. I told my mom I'd look after him. I don't believe in him.
You still covered him up so he wouldn't see you naked.
Yo, it's complicated. Just because I don't believe in it doesn't mean I don't respect his stuff. You don't understand. Just can you stand over there?
Yama Yo lights the candles. Then she lights a cigar and blows the smoke at the sink. Then she pretends to be in a trance.
Ooh, you have three children.
Yes, 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 I do.
I saw the photos in your wallet.
I've only got two photos in there. I never told you there were three of them.
Coincidence. I was dizzy. Maybe I saw three instead of two.
Carry on.
Just to prove to you that I'm making it up, I'm gonna tell you that they are 4, 6, and 9 years old.
It's impossible.
I told you. Of course it's impossible. I'm guessing.
That's exactly how old they are.
Don't fool me.
You got it right. 4, 6, and 9 in 2 months.
Okay, I'm not doing this anymore.
Carry on.
You're fooling around with me.
I swear to God, I'll tell you the truth.
Don't swear to God in my room. You don't even believe in God.
I swear by my children.
What do you do for a job? Lie to people?
Yes! I'm a broker. My job is basically lying to people.
My head hurts.
Don't stop, please. I'll pay whatever you want. Just give some advice. Something. Anything.
$100 for a piece of advice, John.
More if you want. You're a saint. You have power.
I don't like conning people. That's not what I do. I don't even wear makeup so the clients can get a good look at the wrinkles they're paying for. If you want to go to bed with me, I'll be happy to, but if you're looking for a lie...
Yeah, lie to me.
What lie do you want to hear?
Anything. You tell me whatever you like.
See those cobs of corn?
I see them.
Well, then go back to your country and make that what you do.
Cobs of corn?
Yes, there are a lot of people hungry in the world, you know?
That's it?
That's it. You see? Useless.
Corn? Corn flakes?
No, please.
Corn syrup? Biofuels.
What?
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank the Santo.
She's sitting on the bed, looking defeated. John goes up to the altar, kneels in front of Babalu Aye, takes all the cash he has out of his wallet and places it at the feet of the Santo. Then he stands up.
You are incredible.
He leaves. Yemoya stands and takes off her gown. She is naked in front of San Lazaro. He smiles at her.
Scene 9.
Exit, St. Anthony. Exit.
Scene 10, London, UK.
Sean stands with his protege, looking slightly edgy. Oya stands in matching athletic tracksuit. Oya has two gold medallions around her neck.
Thanks for the lift, Coach.
You're all right. We'll make sure you get home all right. You sure you don't want me to drop me in the front door? It's not a problem.
I'm just on the other side of the underpass. It's nothing long. I'll be fine. You all right, Sean?
All right. Yeah. Look, I just want to say, straightforward, you and me, you did all right today. Onwards and upwards and all that.
Is that it?
Take what you're given. I'm not a man of words, you know that.
You properly fooled me, the way you shout instructions. Back straight, head up, chest out, knees high, higher, quicker, quicker!
Well, I'm just a different animal.
You said it, not me.
Well, some moments don't need words. Your action says it all.
Shane, you don't get to leave the competition with anything.
Maybe. My reputation grows. Maybe one day I'll be the most feared trainer in the world.
Ah, you're not that ugly.
Yeah, I'll head off now before the jokes get worse.
Who's telling jokes?
Remember who owns you.
I'm shaking.
You should be.
Oya tucks her medals into her zipped tracksuit. She starts to exit.
What you hiding, Oya?
Whatever you're looking to find, I ain't got it.
That's not right, though, is it?
She shook. Why would I be shook?
How much are you worth, Oya?
Is that a serious question?
As serious your answer?
Can't say without calculating sponsorship.
You should have asked her how much she weighs.
You can't even give me your best price.
I'm not selling anything.
Are you sure you're not sell out?
Not funny. What's this about?
I'm just wondering if there's a finder's fee.
Fee.
I'm thinking if there's no find her fee, it must be a find her, keep her kind of arrangement.
Everyone likes freeness.
I worked hard, won my medals fair and square. You're gonna have to tear my skin off if you're thinking I'm giving them to you without a fight.
I ain't here to scoff with you.
I don't care who I'm fighting. They're not coming off.
Feisty, eh?
In it, though.
Always been like that. That's why I'm drawn to you.
Well, I've never been drawn to you.
Hey, that's my man. Don't think you can run up your mouth, rude gal. Something unfortunate might happen to your legs.
Are you threatening me?
I'm just saying.
Stop gossiping. We ain't on that. Your legs are fine, but they're moving loose.
Moving loose?
Yeah, moving with Dopey.
Like some puppy, like some golden retriever.
Sorry?
Don't mind talking about who owns you. Why you running? You don't have to like what I say about you. You just have to hear it.
I don't want to hear it.
Stop running. Take it as a compliment. I care. Our compliments are like condiments. It's always nice to be offered.
Offer it somewhere else. Here, it's a waste of both of us.
Why are you liking some pink too?
Pink what?
Duppy, always dropping you off. She's linking him hard.
Are you grinding him?
Putting that fat rump up for pork pumps?
That's jocked up. You his bike?
That ain't your business.
You run into me, it's my business.
I don't business what you think.
Do you know what you're doing?
What am I doing?
You're disrespecting yourself.
Oh, how do you work that out?
You really want me to? How's a man like that? Some eggshell man like that. You really think he's ever gonna treat you equally? Like a queen? You're just some trophy to be paraded, looking hard, running fast, maybe even a substitute. Some standing for his white cow, make babies.
What? You don't know shit. I ain't got to listen to your misguided
talking about he owns you. Pinto needs to be dead. You know he needs to dead that talk.
That was just banter, a joke. He trains me. He's my coach.
You run those races. You lead the field, an example of your power. And you're just going to let some Pinto casually pour rank on you?
When did you start to think to get off key, chatting your extreme?
Yeah, you got to ask yourself why you ain't thinking like me.
You're talking about respect, right? Well, I'm good at what I do, and I know Sean respects me.
Does he really, or are you just some prize pony? Because it's not just your coach or whoever he is. It's the whole fucking Union Jack. But that don't stop them from attacking you if you don't run fast enough. Whipping every part of you in the paper for not working hard enough. Because if you're flying, you're British. When you're falling, you become the athlete originally known from that Commonwealth country.
I was born here. I'm worth more than that. I've got plans. This ain't just gonna be my life.
You think you're better? Like they're gonna treat you different? Check yourself. You need to do something whilst you have the power. Show your influence. Your youngers are looking up to you. They want to see a positive example before it's too late and you're just getting slayed. Thinking that's it? That you've been accepted?
Why would I be getting slayed?
So when Pink Toes beating up your pussy, what do you think he's thinking? Because he ain't loving you. He might well, you know, be telling you that he's loving your skin, but really he's just loving being it up.
You want me to offer it up for pumps from you alone, is that it?
No, you ain't. Lakewood don't want no pumps from you.
It don't have to be me. Definitely not some Pink Toe. Your snatch is for a black man to catch you, you get me?
What if I don't want no black man to catch it, pump it, walk it, or whatever euphemism you want to use?
You ain't for him.
Don't you get it?
How you just gonna give it to him like it's nothing?
Why should I give it to a black man? A black man that doesn't value it.
A black man's always gonna have value it.
Is that why they brag about that gal that they've just seen to their boys? Or why they're never around to raise their babies? Why you can't find them for dust? Because the blacker the berry, the quicker the ping. BBM, black brothers missing.
Because you don't know how to look after them. Hold their attention, make them carry on wanting you.
What are you doing if your man stays wanting me?
He don't want you. As if. Tell her you don't want her.
I ain't never said that.
He ain't saying that.
What's he saying then?
Any man could just duck out and not care for his pygmy. It's not just the black man.
There seems to be more though. Come like a trend, like it's cool. It ain't.
Look, don't stray off the point. From the time the white man has sinned against the black man, mistreated us, and now you're gonna let him just come up all in your garden? Plant seeds in your bush like he has a right? A right to just walk up into your threshold like he has a right to do that? Like he still owns your ass plot? Like he should have a free pass like it's nothing? True say you don't owe him diddly. True say you don't, you just some lust, some exotic fantasy. An ethnic conquest. So Pinto can go to the golf club and his members only plantage built corporate ballroom and ramp to his floppy haired, stiff upper lip brethren chatting about, hey, you're not gonna guess what I picked up, scored last night. Yeah. And then they gonna say, what? And he gonna say, a rubber lipped, holy haired darky. And guess what? What? They gonna say, and he gonna say, I liked it. And I'm gonna go back and I'm gonna do it again.
As if you don't walk around sweating when you see a white gal with that porcelain glow, that mannequin figure walking down the street, jumping at attention as if she just sneezes in your
yeah,
direction.
Yeah, to get out of the way, ain't looking to catch no pink toe jumps.
But you'll stick your dick in her, feeding her your myth, making her feel like she's never gonna feel anything like it ever again in her lifetime. You ain't thinking about your sisters, your black queen then, are you? Look to your own business.
Revenge.
Revenge? Revenge what?
Revenge. All these years of abduction, molestation, abuse, and rape of the beautiful black woman. Get our own back.
That's your issue. You know what it sounds like to me?
Now sing it to me, sis.
First of all, I don't sing. Secondly, I ain't your sister, so don't think you can come chat to me like we fan. Thirdly, you just ain't got no self-worth. I don't give a shit what you think of me, however you get it wrong. I ain't gonna try and make up excuses for your laziness, your lack of imagination. But stop picking fights where and whenever you want to start something, because you ain't getting the attention you want. It's boring. I'm bored. Stick to your girl's weaves of hearing stupidness, you know. You want everyone to like you black, white, pinko, Teletubby, or whoever. So stop thinking the white world is out to get you. And if it is, let it be. Let it be for the right reasons, not because of some dumb movements or second-rate complex logic. You're just a human being like everyone else. Stop caring what other people think of you and just do you. Whatever that is, just do you. And admit that you're attracted to me. And I'll admit that I don't like your attitude. And we can leave it at that. If there's no more to say, I need to get home.
The wall and curtain approach her with old Eshu in the door. He opens the door to Oya, and she steps in.
It's dinner time. Saint Anthony said I would trip on a sheshe, but I am still standing. Eggs or chicken stew, Saint Anthony? The choice is yours.
Scene 11, dinner. The Eshu sing to welcome the women. The women arrive. Scene 11A, dinner, USA. A large dinner table.
Yoruba.
I know.
The cosmology, it's polytheistic, but unlike, say,
child, I'm well aware.
You can't really conceptualize it from an American Eurocentric point of view, and also, in the U.S., it's different than the other regions in the diaspora.
Okay, people, the British, they don't really think about that.
Well, they claim that it's like a pidgin form of the Queen's English.
What is?
Black American vernacular.
On TV?
No.
Wait, are we talking about TV?
No.
As opposed to its West African origins, the syntax, the sentence structure.
If they want to claim Ebonics, they can have it. But I don't think your average Brit sits around caring if a black person here says,
but Anglophiles,
I've flown to London or I already flew to London. They're too busy worrying about immigration and Nigerian drug lords, far as I can tell.
So anyway.
So, she comes home calling herself a nigger. She says, I am not a multi-purpose African farm raised in America. Our history may have been eradicated by the transatlantic slave trade, as opposed to what I'm thinking, the Chinese slave trade. I guarantee our village was not the continent of Africa, she says.
That's what I said.
What you say?
Because you couldn't have just rebelled like any other person. Girl's way too old to search for our roots in niggerdom, not to mention walking around wearing a dashiki, which is a man's garment anywhere.
She's not wearing a dashiki.
I bribed her to dress civilized.
I'm right here,
for the
Mom.
Family reunion.
I can hear you. We all can.
Didn't she say she was a lesbian?
Whoa.
Okay, so your little sojourner?
Oye Timpo village.
Is entirely a tourist trap for naive back to Africa's.
Have you been there?
Been there. Before I educify your little girl ass, let me go and break down.
Okay. Wait, so she gets mad at Richard, saying, I ain't picking up your cotton today, when he asked her to do some housework. Now, she's 22, not paying rent, and mixing up metaphors. House slaves didn't pick cotton.
Kids resent their stepfathers. It's natural. And he is white.
What's that supposed to mean? Yes, I noticed my husband is white and is missing dinner.
Have you tried medication?
Excuse me?
For Oshun.
Still here, people.
to suppress her desperate need to construct a false identity through a sophomoric understanding of the African diaspora?
Too much sugar.
I done flown.
She wants Richard and I to pay for her to go get her master's in linguistic anthropology. So she could write a dissertation on how gangster rap is an embodiment of the Yoruba Pepa Langbeshu. Whatever his name is, please. It's a cultural embarrassment, a misogynistic minstrel show, that's what it is.
What is?
Gangster rap.
Oh, I thought you meant
so
something
in other
else.
Words.
Oh, don't get me started.
I'd be flying to London.
She's not bipolar. Complain all she wants about her Jack and Jill upbringing, but this black mama know how to go Negro all up on her ass. And I don't need to pay $50,000.
Niggerly, she's
this
always
been. This copper is delicious.
Oh, thank you, honey.
Sugary, too sugary.
Where's your husband?
I ain't fixing to do business. No flying.
Wait, are you calling my thesis?
I mean, you stretch with the patois of the American Negro.
In Haiti.
Excuse me?
Yeah, you know, not to mention your overall point of view is highly confused.
The lexicon is
earthquake rehabilitation.
And your punctuation sucks.
Oh,
okay. Can you believe how long it took Obama to send help?
If you had to be callow about it, why not be oral historical? Isn't that your point? And wrap your thesis?
I got an A.
Hey!
Anyway, he'll be back on Tuesday.
A what?
Go, girl.
What?
I got an
She got A.
Okay, good.
Now, isn't that great, honey?
committee, you know, I was white.
Motherfucker. Don't you dare denigrate my mental flair. Your points are fair, I do concede, but validation I don't need. I'm not a multi-purpose African, I am a queen. Linguistic supermodel on the scene, I reign supreme, watch me gleam. Mental beauty's what I scream for, with Rosa Parks I do sit-ins, sitting watching Oprah and Obama moving children. So join a truth calls to me, can't you see? Chewing on indifference won't be.
Too sweet, too sweet.
I reclaim what was lost overseas, please let me breathe, evoke my original Yoruba deities, Yemoya, Oshun Oya, the formidable three, not confined to misogynistic ideals of what is sexuality, see? Never a harlot, always a pilot, for civil rights, I run a riot. Study this brainy sequel, cool as Mary's sequel, racism I see through, stand up for my people.
Okay.
Scene 11, dinner, Cuba. I'm hungry.
Well, you have to wait.
It's bad manners to pick at food before everyone sat down.
Who says?
It's basic etiquette.
You're 50 years of revolution and we still worry about that word?
Well, let's try to be decent.
That's another word I hate, decency. It's the next best thing to hypocrisy.
If there are so many words you hate, perhaps you could do us all a favor and shut up.
If you really want me to be quiet, let me eat.
Just feed the sample first.
But I'm hungry.
You're always hungry.
I'm Cuban, morning to night. You can see my spine through my stomach.
There's not enough cutlery.
What's missing?
There's enough spoons for everyone, but there's only 3 forks and 3 knives.
Are you sure?
I don't need a knife. Give mine to our guest.
How are you going to eat your meat?
With my fingers.
Oh, it gives me a headache just listening to you.
He's got no respect for anything, not even basic etiquette.
Come on, sisters, take a look around you. This isn't a tablecloth, it's a sheet. It's the sheet you sleep under every night, Oshun. All right, the drinking water's in an old Coca-Cola bottle. Look, you think he's not gonna notice that? Even I can tell the difference between a serviette and a bit of a toilet roll, and I'm a pig, according to Oya. So don't give me this etiquette bullshit. I ain't never seen you so edgy. He's not some stranger, he's our brother.
You haven't seen him in 15 years. He's almost a stranger.
He'll be exactly the same.
No one's the same after all that time living in another country, speaking another language in a different political system.
Is that all this it's about for you? My brother is foreign now. That's the point.
Don't say that.
It's true. As soon as he decided to leave the country, we started treating him like a dog, calling him a traitor, throwing him out of the house, threw eggs at him. He was a rat, a worm, but not now. Now he's a foreigner. He earns more than we do put together. We live off the crumbs he sends us, and he's here, and he's coming home like a prodigal son. Slay the fatted calf. You know what? Look, this family makes me sick.
Okay, that's enough. It's time to put things behind us. 15 years ago, we threw him out of the house because we believed in something. It was the right thing to do then. The world has changed. I don't care what he's turned into. He's missed us. And that's why he's been able to forgive us. This meal isn't the point. The important thing is being a family again.
The country hasn't changed. If we don't throw eggs, it's only because we haven't got any.
Knock at the door. Brother enters. Brother does the egg dance as the scene resets to Brazil.
Scene 11C, dinner, Brazil. A modest dining room. A small dining table, simply laid, with 4 chairs. 3 of these places are occupied by sisters, Yemenja, Oshun, and Oya.
I am just sick and tired of being happy, see? Can't a decent woman have her share of sadness and grief in this shithole city? They're saying that we'll have not one, but 2 carnivals when the World Cup comes to Salvador. Sometimes I just want to shove this carnival madness up that mayor's ass.
Enter and shoot. I've come back.
Son of a bitch.
I told you, didn't I? Didn't I say? I've got to get out of here. Let me get out of here now before I kill this bastard.
Please?
Please what? Trickster?
I'm offering you a chance to resolve this once and for all. Isn't this for the best?
shut up.
Let him talk, Oya.
Are you really taking his side after all he's done? After what he did to you? To all of us?
No. I'm not taking his side. I want to hear what he's got to say.
Say something, pig.
I don't know. What do you want? Me to ask for forgiveness? Forgiveness for all the shit that happened? I don't know how it all happened. You left the door open and I walked like a dog walking into a church or something.
Is that it? I am not a church. Are you a church, sister?
I'm not a church, sister.
No.
Never been, never wanted to be, and as for the door, it was never open. The door was closed.
It might have been the other way around.
Nope, nope, it wasn't. And if it had been, I wouldn't have done it.
Oh, come on!
You fucking trickster!
Hey, what happened, happened. What can be done now? This is shit. I couldn't help it, I'm sorry.
Why don't you stick your big sorry up your ass?
You understand. You're older. You know.
All I know is you owe me. You owe me and you owe them.
But if it's a question of money, then
money! Give me your clothes.
Eshu looks at Yemenja as if he hasn't quite understood what she has said. Oshun and Oya look at Yemenja too, but the latter pays them no attention.
Get out there, take off your clothes. Money might come into it, but we don't need yours. Just take off your clothes.
It wouldn't be the first time.
As Shu stands up and moves away from the table, he hesitates.
If this is the only way to put this shit away forever?
Containing his distrust, he starts to remove his clothes. He takes off his shirt, then starts to remove his
What do you want now? Whip me, burn me, fill me naked.
Dance. I want you to dance.
How do you mean?
D-A-N-C-E. Don't you know what that is?
Up the dance how?
Get on with it.
As Shu looks around, he looks at the sisters. It's as if he's about to follow Yemenja's order and dance, but he still doesn't do it.
Dance!
He dances badly. Yemenja stares at him for a time before finally moving towards the door.
I'm going.
No, we didn't we come here to eat? Why would we leave the food behind? Because of him? Not today.
Oshun sits down at the table. Yemenja and Oya look at each other.
Today we eat.
Yemenja and Oya go to the table and sit down. The three girls start to eat. As Shu starts to get it on, the girls start to take notice. He climbs on the table. They leave while he gyrates. He realizes they have gone. Scene 11D, dinner, UK.
Papa's day. The rest of the family in their respective places around the table stand up. Baba is sat stooped in a wheelchair. Yemaya slowly carries in a cake with lit candles. Everyone puts on masks. The Obama, the Queen, etc.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Baba. Happy birthday to you. For he's a jolly good fellow. For he's a jolly good fellow. But he's a jolly good fellow.
Where is my blessing?
It's not time yet.
Blow, Papa.
Who's that?
Will you please take off your silly mask?
You don't like it.
It's a lovely gesture presided over and recognized by dignitaries.
I suppose those communists.
He's 100 years old. He's not getting a knighthood.
He should.
It's true. 100 years old. They should be here celebrating with him. If Papa was still in Trinidad, they would give him something.
Give me my blessing.
He's on his way. Oh, the guests.
Again?
Yes.
I thought after last year.
What happened last year?
He was rude.
Oh, let's not drag that up again. I don't want his shadow over today's guest.
I was traumatized.
What happened?
Some sort of bush, doctor.
Oh, it was a witch doctor, more like.
Oh, watch your mouth.
He wasn't a bush witch doctor.
Just bush, spraying water, chatting, slapping people with spinach, the whole shebang.
I remember he got a bit wavy.
Wavy? He was like an African Richard Pryor, loud, drunk, offensive, cussing people out.
Called mom smothering.
He explained himself. He said I was caring and nurturing, that sort of thing, not derogatory.
He said some inaccurate things as well.
Called Oshun attention seeking.
He was rude.
He claimed it was part of his foresight, judgment calls on people's nature. Like a tarot, palm reader sort of thing. It's a regular thing.
Oh, okay.
On granddad's birthday, a stranger turns up.
An invited guest. Whispers to dad, he says how long he'll live or something. Papa will live forever, isn't that right?
You called Oya a reckless homewrecker.
You shouldn't attack his sister like that.
What? How am I? Are you siding with her?
No, just saying it's not nice.
Well, we all know what he said about you.
Quite a shocking accusation. I mean, talk about it.
A womanizing drunk. That's what he said.
He said that.
I don't care about what you call yourself. You shouldn't be allowed to just crucify good people. I'm a good person.
Is he coming again? It's not the same guy. It's a different babalawo.
A baba what?
Babalawo.
That means crazy African bush doctor in English.
It does not. He's making fun of things he doesn't understand.
Doorbell rings.
Oh, I'll go.
Here we go.
This guy coming is a serious thing. Reminds Papa of home. It's not a joke. It's a serious ritual.
Baba.
My blessing.
Yes, I hope you'll be pleased. He's coming highly recommended, a man of great spiritual sense and respect for ancient traditions. He's here to deliver your blessing. He's here to deliver your blessing, and he is Babalawo Odilomi.
Alan enters, dressed in African garment.
Well, very happy to be with you all this evening. Please, just call me Alan.
This is different. Did you just say your name was Alan?
Yes.
This is exciting.
You're telling me.
He looks the part. Oh,
very African.
I feel as if I'm intruding.
Oh, don't be silly. You were invited. We were expecting you. Come meet Papa.
What is this?
Your blessing.
No, don't mock me.
I'm here to do no such thing. Just to bring you a lafia.
I do not welcome this.
What did you say to him?
Peace. A lafia means peace.
Oh,
that's good, isn't it? Peace is good. Peace, Alan.
This day has been a long time coming.
What does that mean?
Onomiji no lati debi.
Koto temi.
Agbinyo juri ayo.
Asheshe.
It's not a mistake. This is my culture. In your hands.
I didn't hand him anything. Alan prostrates himself.
Did I hand him anything?
Did you see me give him something?
No, I didn't.
Alan prostrates himself in front of Papa, touching his right cheek, then his left cheek to the floor before getting up.
I know who you are. I am blessed to know who you have always been. Baeshu, Lalo, Okirioko, Kiriogo, Dimoniiko, Onotumare, Ati Orishe, Ati Egun, Iuni Ulua, Au Eriona, Ariba, Jusu. Ila urun, iwo urun, imoni ulupamo, ashe orisha, imoni uluso, ino agbafu, rere ati buburu, imoni olua, ailo, imoni olua ian, esi, ati iparu.
Scene 12. Epilogue.
If I change my name tomorrow, would my journey stay the same? Could you ride on a persona, arriving Hall of Fame? Should I reach a destination far away from me? Will there be a hall of mirrors revealed for all to see? You know that all that glitters is not gold, if stories have been told. That all in all will come to she who waits. So within ourselves are we divine, seek a truth, and will we find that we are never meant to see what we can be?
So, one day, woman sets off on a long journey. She pays homage to Eshu and asks all the Orishas to accompany her on her arduous task. They set off as one, but as each crossroads presents itself, one by one, they find reason to abandon her. I cannot cross the river in these shoes. I am late for my dance class. I have to help my father kill his favorite chicken. Only Orumila, the most steadfast of the Orishas, remains, but as the greatest obstacle approaches, he too makes his excuse. Even you, cries the devotee. You have all left me when I needed you most. You are supposed to be my guides. Orinika, says the deity, you only have your Ori. In the ultimate test, it is only your inner head will guide you truthfully. Orinika. One other thing before I go. My uncle has inherited $14 million, which is, as we speak, sitting in a secure savings bank in Lagos. However, he needs to transfer it to a recognized bank in the UK in order to access it. If you act fast and facilitate this transfer, you will be entitled to 6% or roughly $800,000 by Tuesday. Please come to me with your bank details to take part in this huge bonanza. My name is Eshu, and I will be in the bar after the...
Chicken is on stage. Next to him, old Eshu sharpens a knife. The company sings a sheshe.
End of play. Thank you.
love your bridge.
So, thank you all for staying, and first of all, I think Awoye as the director, but also the actress, deserve really another round of applause. Yeah. Maybe I ask Elyse first, what comes to your mind when you see the New York one-day rehearsal of a project you worked over for a year in the UK?
Just amazing. And to see your responses is really just shows how this story works everywhere.
Tell us a little bit more about the original idea. It's such an unusual a project. Tell us a little bit. You mentioned it, but how did it work, and with what countries, what playwrights, how do you coordinate the...
Well, we had playwrights originally from the three countries that we'd been working on in this project, Nigeria, Cuba, and Brazil, but we decided to bring in the United States, and because there were so many great writers we could work with, and because we know that there's... You know, this is really related. And of course, how could we do that and not bring in the UK as well? And there's a huge Yoruba culture there. So we, in the end, we knew we would go for five writers, but the original project had probably, between 15 and 20 writers from all of those countries coming over to London on two occasions. It should have been more, but we couldn't always afforded, and working together in this workshop with Rufus, Norris, and myself, and musicians. We had a Cuban choreographer, and we had Shola Akinbole, who did the music, and Michael Henry, so from Britain. And over a period of time, we had to hone it down to the five writers. So Brazil was Marcus Barbosa, Cuba was Yunior Aguilera. The UK was Gbolahan. The US was Tanya Barfield, which is a shame because she's in LA, so she's not here. And I forgot one. Oh, Nigeria was Rotimi, Babatunde. So in the end, those were the five writers. And of course, in weaving the stories, the actors and the director all, you know, managed to put that together too.
What did you discover in the process of developing the project that surprised you, that you...
I think almost the same thing that surprised me today, that there are just some forces working in this story that's sort of beyond any of us and that touches all of us. It very specifically touches the journey that was made and the cultures that have been so deeply affected and have had such an effect on other cultures. But I think anyone who sees this work really respects how much of the story is part of them. I saw that here.
Yeah, so thank you. Rufus, by the way, is now became the director of the National Theatre in London, so that is also quite...
His god, his Orisha, is a Shossi who has one arrow but always gets a bullseye. So...
That is amazing. How was, as the last question, how was the audience reaction in London? How long was the run? Tell us the space where it was done.
It was at the Young Vic, beautiful theatre in the main house, and the audience was absolutely packed and full and lively and participating. You can imagine, there was lots of opportunity to participate. So it was absolutely joyful. As well as being a very deep and profound and tragic story as well.
Thank you. Awoye, we asked you some time ago, but not too long ago, when to put your teeth into this apple of a play. What was your experience?
It's been amazing. It's been such a whirlwind. I mean, for me, the thing I was so excited about is You know, I feel like we're in this moment in history where we get to kind of put pieces together that feel like they spent centuries getting torn apart. So it's really exciting to be able to think about Yoruba culture, West African culture as a large, and where the bonds between Africa and the rest of the world have been maintained, do you know? And I mean, it's so, the kind of classic example of what this means to put everything together. We're having rehearsal today, and Larry, our amazing musician, Max, who's our amazing tap dancer who studied Afro-Cuban music, but who's from Austria, and then our dancer who's from Cuba. We're rehearsing, and she started doing a dance that is a Legba's dance, and both of them just started singing a Legba song, and they just created this amazing music together. They've never met each other before. They come from three different countries, but there's something that unites all of them. So it's been fun to kind of see where all those pieces are and to bring in these amazing actors, many of whom are Nigerian, some of whom are American, and just kind of see what all those kind of connections and fusions are. So it's been fun, yeah.
And do you have a personal connection also to Yoruba, or how do you know?
You know, it's so interesting. I mean, for me, what's been great is I also get to learn. So my family's from Ghana, but it's so interesting because as I was talking to a Nigerian Yoruba scholar the other day, like my family, my name is from the Ewe tribe in Ghana, which kind of spreads from Ghana to Togo to Benin, which kind of sits on the border of where Yoruba is also. So there's like even just linguistically these kind of connections, even though it's not my particular culture or religion or anything like that. So for me, it's been also a great learning experience too. You know, I mean, I think there's a lot of things within our larger continental African culture that we can all connect to, but learning about the different orishas and the gods and all these kinds of things that I've been learning for years to be able to bring that all together now has been cool. Yeah.
Yeah. So very often what we see in New York is, in quotation marks, the well-made British play. There's a beginning and an end, and people sit around a table, and then they talk and things. This is so different in the structure. I mean, the way it's a collage, perhaps the great art form coming out of the 20th century. But how do you feel? Does the work will theatrically and the dramaturgy of it would audiences respond to this here? What is your?
I feel like actually, people can respond to it almost sometimes even more deeply when things are set up in vignettes than when they're set up in a narrative through line, just because the way that we talk and we think and we remember, the way that we have memory is not linear, you know what I mean? So it's really, I feel like all of these vignettes, it's about us capturing the spirit of each of those vignettes and letting those things live together. But I think that kind of floaty nature of it, that feeling of, oh, this thing is present, but it's also ancient. Those two things are living with each other at the same time. So I feel like in a way it feels almost more natural than structuring everything linearly. It's like, it's just our being in a way. You know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely. I do. And I do like the archaeology of the project. It really feels like there was some digging over centuries and taking things out. And the temporality that actually, perhaps life on life force are not linear, like one, this one dies, and this. Maybe it is a circle, maybe things are connected. And, you know, there is no, you know, history of theater. It sort of was the Greek, and then there was a time nothing, and then the French and the Germans, and then Dada and this, and then, you know, playwriting. Maybe, you know, there is something that connects us all on a level, and especially, of course, this project sort of really made me think of the ways how that's a temporality of the modernity or of a culture and this archaeology could be brought on a stage in such a lively matter. And I thought it is quite quite inspiring to see, and also perhaps a model for projects about many, many other subjects, about many other cultures, because there could be the case made, this is what, if it works here, it could work for others. And perhaps it is a playwriting of a 21st century to go away from the one author and to collage material and still have a dramaturgy. Sade, thank you.
Did you just discover that Western culture isn't the only form?
No, the
of
linear
high form. Art?
No. Actually, we do a lot here.
What I just mean is that what you articulated beautifully is the drumbeat of indigenous cultures around the world. We have been expressing ourselves from an indigenous point of view that has been powerful and that has created, you know, transcontinental languages and rituals and ways of understanding and being that have sustained this globe. And I think that it's brave and exciting that this piece is brought here, because what we can see is that this, and it's reflective of what's happening in the world right now, right? These kind of, the coming down of walls, the coming down of colonial thinking, of linear thinking, ways to rethink our well-being and our holistic care of each other, comes from these non-linear kind of indigenous ritualistic cultures and languages that tip the kind of the mainstream art world on its head and creates possibilities for what can be, which is so exciting, you know, and like now more than ever in this day and age, how exciting to have something where you can recontextualize something as traditional as the derivation of some of the institutions that brought this here with this wonderful folkloric stories that kind of are a quilt of indigenous culture.
So what was your reaction to the story, watching it and seeing it?
My reaction, that's an interesting question. I will just say this. You know, National Black Theater was founded in 1968, so we kind of tackle a bit of that time period. And what we were committed to when my mother founded the theater was ritualistic theater. She didn't believe in the fourth wall. She didn't believe in art for art's sake, right? So she believed that our purpose for creating art was to create dialogue, to create healing within our communities, and you couldn't do that if you didn't tell your stories from your purview, from your POV. And that if Black folks, in particular, were going to find any liberation in a country that brought them here enslaved, we had to have a past that did not begin at our enslavement. And so that the natural connection would be to the continent. Now, the continent is huge, right? Why Yoruba? And so what I found to be about this piece in particular that was so interesting, what kept popping up for me, and Awoye, you did an amazing job, was that Yoruba culture was like the Underground Railroad, right? This common language spoken on transcontinental, in transcontinental ways that created a common language hidden by Catholicism, by colonialism, by all of these things, but its point of preservation was liberation. And we see that from the 1700s to today in this play. And so for me, that was remarkable, to be able to kind of trace through narrative this journey of our liberation by any means necessary.
The play did start in the 1700s. You came, I think, a couple of minutes late, but so it is truly, and quite a remarkable way of storytelling. So would that be a play, would you think, that could be put on? What do you think? Would people come in New York? Did it have to be changed?
Well,
who could put this on? Or is that something that is better suited for London?
No, I mean, so that's the thing. We've been doing Yoruba plays since time immemorial, like since the beginning. If you come to the theater, all of our walls are created with art that tells the folklore of Yoruba. Who's the playwright who's in the blue and brown waters? He's doing Yoruba stories. So can it be done? Yes. Has it been done since for centuries? Now, who's the audience? And how do you turn on an audience, a traditional theater audience, to something that may feel less traditional? I think that's the key. But will it work as theater? Yeah. It worked tonight. It's worked for the last 50 years that we've been doing it. It continues to work in modern playwrights, and I'm sure what you found with all the playwrights that you worked with, that it was an incredible experience that really translated to audiences. But finding the audience that can really appreciate not only the cultural references, but the power of what you were describing in non-linear ways to perform and look at theater, I think that's what we have to figure out completely.
Any more comments before maybe we open up to some questions, but some more?
I think one of the things that's really tremendous about this piece that Sade is...
Can you hold a bit closer? Yeah.
That Sade is kind of touching on as well is about where do stories get told and how do those stories get told? So, for example, the work that NBT has been doing for the past 48 years now is all about how to tell stories about Black people from around the diaspora. I think the thing that's really exciting about the piece is these stories are stories that we hear. I mean, I'm first generation American. It's like when I hear them arguing around the dinner table, it's like that's a story I know. It's like I understand that dichotomy of existing kind of also between two cultures. It's very familiar. It's so then it's not about is it understandable or relatable or accessible, but more about where are all these stories going to get told, not that they are difficult to understand, but who is getting to hear these stories and where are the stories getting told. And I think that in a place also where we are as a country figuring out how to rewrite narratives, how to rewrite the narratives of who we are in kind of our popular culture, we have to take all of the core of who we are and make sure all the stories are getting told so that we can make sure that we're telling a correct and true narrative of who we are. You know what I mean?
Well, thank you. I think that is true, and also your comments, and to see where's the audience, but it also might bring in an audience, a new audience, and and another one. So I can't wait to see that. And I wish I had a little magic hat. I say, here's enough money, do it. Work 3 months on it. I think it would be a sensational production. Actually, I do think
it's beautiful.
Quite a landmark play, and there could be maybe even variations. Something written again, you know, right now. So
yeah, right.
Another one. So that is what would bring you back. Elyse is actually a Brooklyn girl, right? And and now since 25 years at the Royal Court in London. But maybe some comments or questions from the audience, some impressions. I think that would be very meaningful for Elyse and for the director and for you to hear some.
It's a great project, but there is a little trap. I mean, it's too early to see if you are going to fall on the trap. But it's kind of like a view of like the African identity from outside. So it's kind of like a colonial view of African culture. So my question, the segue is, do you plan to do other projects, let's say East African languages and stories and South African, and you know, because Africa, I think it's kind of like a colonial view that it's like this one unique like block, but it's very diverse and very profound and very diverse. And is the project gonna go there, or you're gonna stay with the Yoruba project? Thank you.
I just want to say that I call all of this work told from the inside, not from the outside, and that all of the writers were telling it from their own experience, which was mostly inside the culture. But yes, to answer your question, we work all over the world, and we've just had an incredible project in South Africa with 12 writers working in many different languages. And also, we actually started our work 25 years ago in Uganda in East Africa. This isn't telling the story of Africa. It's telling a very specific story, but we always say the more specific, the more universal it becomes.
I'm just curious why you thought it was not in any kind of, what felt colonial about it?
I mean, I don't know about the project, but I didn't know if there were more languages. Like,
They were speaking English. Is that
No. They're like picking Yoruba and then making the connections, like the Nigerian connections, let's say, with Brazil and Cuba, while, you know, why Nigeria? It could be like other places.
Well, that's the seat of the Yoruba is in Nigeria. So you can go to Oshogbo, to the bush, go to the Oshun Groves. I mean, it is the seat of Yoruba culture worldwide is in Nigeria. And it has roots and diasporic reaches out throughout the continent and throughout Brazil, Cuba, America, Nice.
But maybe let's go. You had like one, and then two, and then three. Then four, maybe, yes.
Thank you. So that was definitely a provocative question. I'm tempted to answer that, but I think that more people have things to say. I want to say, you know, that I really enjoyed the play. So, you know, I thank everybody who was involved in it. I'm a graduate student here in urban education, and I'm particularly interested in linguistics. So I saw myself reflected throughout it. I'm also an initiated priestess in Haitian voodoo. So I'm looking at it, and I'm seeing myself reflected. I'm seeing the what I call, you know, in, there's translanguaging happening, there's trans-dialecting happening that I can relate to growing up in New York City, being African American, you know, being growing up in, you know, Brooklyn, New York, Flatbush, Brooklyn, where there's all kinds of, you know, there's a multi-ethnic black identity, you know, throughout New York City and in particularly in those areas. So when I think about, you know, in terms of the audience, I think, wow, how wonderful would it be for youth, particularly in New York City, to be able to be exposed to that. So the children who were here, you know, it was, you know, they were a little bit young for some of the content, you know, you know, but for, I think, from, you know, for more mature, you know, audience, for high school, I think that it's crucial to have this kind of work because it's speaking to their experience, it's speaking to that, you know, to that third space, right, that you were talking about, you know, the, you know, kind of the third world, third culture children, right, it's speaking to that identity. So I think it's really important. And then I also want to say that as I was watching it, I was thinking about, you know, I'm not too much read up on it, but I was thinking about Vere Clark, thinking about literary theory, and I was thinking about, you know, Vere Clark's idea diasporic literacy. Right, so it's something that I'm really interested in, this idea that, you know, that you're interpreting that there's certain, you know, certain forms, right, certain folklore forms, certain, you know, forms of expression that, you know, that it's critical, you have to have this kind of diasporic perspective in order to translate it, in order to understand it, you know, so because it's not rooted in one tradition, but it's something that kind of happens, it's like this creolization, right, that happens with language, with expression, with identity, and so that's what was running through my mind, you know, is this, wow, we really need more of this diasporic literacy, we need more text, we need more, you know, more forms of literary expression that reflects that, because so many children, I grew up in the 80s, and, you know, forget about it now, these children who are growing up now, it's even more so. So I think that a play like this is something that more accurately reflects their lived experiences. So I think that, you know, that it'll really take off in other, you know, really throughout, wherever you have black people, it's gonna take off, you know? And then I think other people will be able to connect to it too, but I'm particularly interested in the children.
Thank you, yeah, thank you. What was number two, was there? Yes.
Thank you. Sereme, Buiti Gunyun, Husungube, Gunyunle. I'm speaking Garifuna. It's a language that my ethnic group from where I come from speaks still, and we strictly connected with Yoruba, of course, because the African from where we descend came to St. Vincent, the Grenadines, where they mixed with Caribbean and other indigenous people, Arawaks, and we are the results, and still my people still lives in Central America where we develop and still fighting. Something that is very important, I really appreciate of this play, is the fact that it's not resolved. What I mean by that is that you just pick yourself and identify yourself with that because you're looking everybody very well defined. Mm-hmm. But because you go deep into the spiritual part, and you have to find yourself. Mm-hmm. And I think that is a very important thing for us to connect, mm-hmm, and not forget the aspect that really holds us. Mm-hmm. Sade, that's your name. Yeah. You mentioned something that really struck me very much, is that you said that in order to identify yourself, we have to go to all the aspects of the Yoruba tradition, the religion aspect, and I find that in us, and it's important in order to be strong in this actual time in 21st century, we need to connect, mm-hmm, and to connect with our identity. And that force, also I saw it in the representation of different deities, is that we as a woman, we represent that. And we need to connect with that. Thank you.
Hi, I'm of course an academic and an Africanist, and my work is exactly this. I begin in Yoruba land and I go all over, and I spend my summers between Nigeria, Brazil, Cuba, and the South. And I'm writing, my next book is actually on dramaturgy and on literature and the connections in all of these using the Yoruba paradigms. So I'm very interested in finding out if there's a text, you know, written text that I could use, because I already have the paper in my head that I'm going to write.
There is a text, yes.
Yeah, and
yes,
where I can get it. And also, I would love to speak to you more, because I work with an Afro-Brazilian theater group in Brazil, Bando de Teatro Oldum. And they're doing
in Salvador.
In Salvador,
well, they've
yeah,
been, you know, one of the groups that have been involved in this,
yeah,
project.
Yeah, and I was, yeah, this is exactly what they would do, and, okay, you know, kind of like bringing that stuff, you know, bringing it all together, you know, and I'm working on translations of the Bando's work, so, you know, it's this is really bringing all the work full circle, and I congratulate you on this. It's wonderful.
Tell us a bit, what did you see in the play when you watched it?
Well, definitely the connections. And the way that the deities are expressed all across the, you know, in the different realms. And even the fact that at the very end you brought in Xangô, yes, like, well, you brought back to Trinidad, and, you know, I immediately thought of the Trinidadian Baptists, mm-hmm, you know, and then, of course, the white priest who was initiated. Mm-hmm. There's a whole new layer of phenomena that's coming out in the African world. And so it's like, and of course, Asese, you know, Yemoja, the songs and everything, those songs are very pan-African, pan-diasporic. Yeah. They're songs that are very particular, but those songs in particular that you use, you find them everywhere. Everywhere you go and you travel, those are the like the central songs,
yeah,
you know? So there's so much, everything is there, and the characteristics of the deities, it's all there, you, yeah, know?
I have to say, I love the white babalao because, one, you know, you see more and more of it, and it's always when you walk into a room, like, but then when you think about it too, like, so my head is Yemaya, and one of the places that I was raised was in the Oshun Groves in Oshogbo, and if you've ever been, it's a UNESCO sacred site, and it's all carved with new sacred artwork, and the mother of the grove is a German woman,
right,
Suzanne Wenger, who passed away a few years ago, but she was a Oshun priestess, and the artwork that has come out of Nigeria for the last however long, she was really the foremother of protecting and making sure that that work got into the world and preserved, and so I loved that, even that bridge. Mm. Too.
Well, really quick, I'm working basically like in this genre as well, but I'm just starting into it. But from a dance perspective, yes. And I'm gonna do a project this coming like spring. So it was like, that's why I came out to see it. So I really appreciate this is going on, and I would love the, like the text as well. But first I want to say that this particular format of nonlinear storytelling kept me present. Mm-hmm. So it was very, like what she said, that the children could really relate to it because it keeps you so present, you don't have to think about the past. And you're thinking about the past, you're thinking about your present, you're thinking about your future. And that nonlinear thinking actually like affords us that and like lets us be able to create from this moment, because it keeps us right here in the moment, like while it's happening, as opposed to thinking like things are happening in this timeline, but things are happening and right now. So that was really appreciated. But I have a very specific question. it deals with the like toward the end, the last text, when the white Babalao came, right? And when he spoke at the end. So I was thinking, okay, I would love to know, like have a translation for what he was saying to him. Mm-hmm. So that was the only part where I was like, okay, I was just very curious. Like I got the point, but then I also wanted to know like what was being said.
Think about it like opera. Half the time you don't know what they're saying, but you can feel it, you know? And I think it's powerful that the Yoruba language was being spoken. One of the plays that we developed through our playwright residency was in Abibio. 30% of it was in Abibio. So the opening scene is two Nigerian women at JFK Airport speaking their native language. And the playwright, who's a Nigerian, first generation Nigerian, she made sure that 30% was done in Abibio because, and this is what I thought you were getting at, was Africa is not a country, it's a continent. And the tongue of our people is varied, and we never get to hear our tongue, right? We hear English, we hear French, we hear all of the derivations of the colonial, of the people that colonized the continent. But to have that moment where you actually get to hear Yoruba, you don't know what it is, but you can feel it. Mm-hmm. And that's what, and it happens all the time. Opera, it's perfect. It's all in Italian. What the hell are they saying? I don't know, but I love it, and I'm a subscription holder, so.
And you know, I think it's just going off of that too, and like all these different things that we're saying about connectivity between places. It's that, you know, like one of the really interesting things in the script, the way that the language is written out to guide the actors is phonetically, so they can hear it. But the Yoruba language is a tonal language. And so when we think about the way language is spoken, and then a language that gets stripped away, but then gets pushed into other things like music, right? So suddenly there's like a new vocabulary, like the music has taken over the vocabulary of the voice, and that's something that has pulsed through time, right? So that even someone as a tap dancer, the evolution of that form of dance is all connected to those rhythms. So the things that he's speaking are the rhythms that we feel inside of us. It's our pulse. It's like the way we understand breath and who we are. So even without the words, I think that was the intent probably of having him speak, and it wasn't projected. Exactly. And the sense that this person, there's a truth to him that is connecting to the truth of the father. You know what I mean? Yeah.
I should just add that, of course, the play was written partly in Spanish and Brazilian Portuguese, and they would, and that bit was translated, but so there were many languages involved in the play. Yeah,
I was just going to echo what they both talked about in terms of, for me, the flash point was the white babalao. I was in Cuba yesterday, and I went to a rumba ceremony, and half of the dancers were white. And I walked in and I was really shocked, but it was momentary because it was so, everything just gelled. It was like I saw that for a minute. And afterwards I did ask one of the performers, I said, oh, how did you come to do it? And he said, oh, a British guy too. And he said, oh, I just took a million and one classes. That's all, you know. But it was with so much ease and just a communication between, you know, all of it. And it was really impressive for me, and I really actually liked that about the ceremony, that they were really, that the language of the dances and the culture and was sort of transcended all of that, right? Mm-hmm. Which you don't see here as much, which is I think was beautiful for me. And seeing it there, just sort of, again, with the white guy, just sort of brought it alive.
Yeah. And not to say that sometimes that is problematic, right? Like it's not, and what was great about that scene was everybody had a different reaction, you know? And ultimately the blessing was recognized by the elder, yes. And that's what really mattered. But to, that dynamic can be troublesome. It's not all gravy.
I just wanted to add that many of the people I've talked to over the years, one of the things they talk about is how Africa is colonizing everybody and how, in fact, the powers are being inverted through the spiritual paradigm. And within the spiritual paradigm, everyone comes to the sources of knowledge who are usually black folks, and they're bowing down to these sources of knowledge because they recognize that this transcendent sphere, this kind of other articulate, this other knowledge is something that they need. Like the young man, the man who needed the instruction from Yemenja to go get his biofuel wealth, you know, that they're understanding that there's something else that they're gaining. And so they're willing to forget, or, you know, they transcend their ethnicities and their colors in order to kind of bow to what Africa has given the world.
Okay, thank you. Actually, I'm a Yoruba person, so I grew up in Nigeria. So I really enjoy the play. So I like the culture and the tradition that it portrays, and then the links between the Orishas, the Yemoja, the Osun. And I think one thing that was missing, we didn't see, Ogun, which is a very important Orisha and Yoruba land. As one of the, characters there. And also towards the end, I think instead of Babalawo, you know, revealing something, it should have been Orumila. So, because he's the grand priest. So, and I think another scene, maybe in the play, Kola not also play important role in Yoruba land, and I think maybe that one could have also set certain stage, when you are talking about Ori, for example. So Kolanut will have been an important symbol that can be used, so in that regard. So I really enjoy it. I think it's really good.
And so many difficult choices to make, because there were, but I agree that Ogun is a very important deity to.
But I think that there's also something to be said for breaking from tradition, because you're right, you're absolutely right. And I think that's that when you start to link the tradition with theater, and especially, I don't know, the playwrights, but a lot of first generation have one step removed from the tradition. So they may not throw kola nut, but they understand who's the Orisha for their head. And I think it's important to start telling also first generation stories of how their culture got translated through that third experience. So you're absolutely correct about the symbols and the way the tradition is traditionally practiced. I also want to add that there's something very exciting about the modernity of the transatlantic translation of tradition.
And of course, to focus on the women, that was a decision that all the writers made, that they would choose the three female, the strongest female deities.
I was excited to see the children here. I think that was, I was just so sad to see them not here for the Q&A, because they could have really given us an insight into their culture. In the late 90s, I helped develop the New York City Board of Ed Project Arts website, and one of the things that I tried to do, and we did, was try and look at where the kids were coming from and what their interest was, and what was their interest but music, language, fashion, and sex. But a lot of their culture, especially the black kids, came from Africa, and they didn't know that. So one of the things that we were trying to do was show them their language and their music, that it came from there, so they would have roots, because many of us don't have roots, whether we're black or wherever. We come from some other place. And I loved your comments about what I call experiential storytelling, the nonlinear storytelling, because that really engaged me. And I love that it was in the middle, because we felt like we were not just we versus them. And I think that's one of the things that's there. The question is, how do you bring this to young people? and revise it so that maybe they catch on and want to learn more about their culture?
I mean, at National Black Theater, we do, I mean, we've done Orisha plays forever. I think the folklore of Orisha plays and indigenous cultural plays just lends itself to young people. But our founder, my mother, Dr. Barbara Ann Teer, the point of putting on these kinds of productions were for, I mean, our first ensemble, like our opening company, were all teenagers. I mean, now they run the show and they're elders, but it started out to give youth an identity in this country that gave them roots past their enslavement.
I would like,
quickly too. I think that, you know, I think the really interesting thing about a piece like this is because it's something that we don't see very often, I think we're tempted to frame it as something outside of ourselves when it's not, when it's something that's very integral to who we are on every level. So in terms of, I think, bringing young people in, bringing all audiences in, it's about just making the connection of who we are fundamentally as people, rather than, you know, I always say this about Shakespeare, people say, oh, they feel like it's something outside of themselves. It's not outside of you. He's talking about something very essential to human nature. And I feel like that's the thing that this play captures too. It's like, what's the way that we're all connected? Not that we have to reach outside of ourselves to access something. How does it affect us at our core, you know?
I would like to ask, one of our actors, how did it, maybe come a bit closer here, and Yu Chen can give you a mic, but how did it feel to be asked to be in the play? What did you expect, and what came out of it, and so what was your experience?
Yeah, actually, I'm going to try not to cry. So. It was very emotional for me, and surprising, because I have been in Washington State, actually, doing a teaching artist residency out there, and I have a 2-month gap, so I came to New York. And then I think the day after I landed, I got an email from Awoye, like, would you like to be in this reading? I got your contact from Chinyere Anyanwu, who is a really phenomenal casting director who really does a great job of staying in touch with actors of African descent, usually first generation African American. And it's been emotional for me because first of all, I'm sitting in this room, and I think for the first time in my life, I'm realizing that, I'm Yoruba, and I'm first generation Nigerian American, and growing up, I grew up in New York City, and I would meet people who were first generation Caribbean American, first generation Puerto Rican American, first generation Dominican American, and I always felt some sort of tie to them, but I never knew exactly what it was. And now I'm 30, I'm gonna turn 31 on Wednesday. And just being back in New York and specifically being in this room, I'm seeing people who are from St. Vincent, and I see the Yoruba in them, Haiti, and I see the Yoruba in them, and Trinidad, and I see the Yoruba in them, and it's like, whoa, Yoruba is, there's a lot of people who are Yoruba, you know, it's not just Nigeria anymore. So now I feel like, okay, I've got these cousins across the world, and that's why all these years they've been somewhat speaking to me spiritually. It's also emotional for me because when I finished reading the script, I was reminded of a romantic relationship that I was in. It was my first relationship, and it was with a man who was Igbo American, and he was a little bit older than me, and he practiced capoeira. And so he would tell me these things about Ifa, and I didn't know anything about Ifa. My parents raised me Christian. My father was Muslim. There are a lot of Muslims in Nigeria, and usually people who go down that path choose to, I can't even say it's a choice because of the type of schools they go to, they're not encouraged to embrace Ifa. They basically have to cut it off. And they still are Nigerian and they're proud, but the religious aspect is cut off. So being in that relationship, it made me open my eyes and sort of reconnect with Yoruba heritage. And so this play reminded me of that reconnection and how important it is for me to hold on to that, especially now that I'm coming into a time in my life where I'm thinking about family and what am I going to pass down to my children? Are they going to be watered down? Or because I know I'm already watered down and I don't want them to water down anymore. So it's been very crucial for me, not just as an artist, but personally, to be a part of this reading. And I really do hope that it becomes a production here in the US.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Well, I think that was a wonderful, I think, a moment to keep in the room, you know, and think about it and approach it. But I think I would like to thank you all for coming. Also, you know, thank you so much for Sade for joining us again. Awoye, this is remarkable, and at least to have the vision with the writers to create something. It's an experiment. You never know how do things work out. Do they come out? It's very courageous. And I think you found something in there, and it is really our hope that it works out. So perhaps if you know people and who are in the position to make decisions, you know, tell about the story, or maybe some do your own work, or you know, include it, whatever it is. But I think this was a remarkable evening. I'm so honored and proud that we could do this here at the Segal Center. I was this summer in Sao Paulo and I saw the Afro-Brazilian Museum, and you had told me about the play, and it was such a world, something it spoke to me, and said we now finally should do it, and I'm really, really honored. Also, thanks
and
for
Antje. I said, no, it's not possible.
Yeah, she said, Frank, forget about it, you can't do this. I said,
music, dance, yeah, how can you do it as a reading?
And I said, that's a good reason to say, yes, we can, but, so we went back and forth, and she said, but you have to watch the DVD at least, yes. But I also want to thank Antje for helping us to make that happen, and to everybody. So thank you, and join us for a little reception. Thank you.